session now, God, for tonight. Thank you, God, for those that are here. Pray, oh God, now for those that are not, oh God, we ask that you continue to give us grace over this night, oh God. We ask that you continue to give us protection and anointing, oh God. We pray, Master, for a strong word, a stable word, oh God, a solid word. We pray most of all, oh God, we have a revelant word, Master, we'll be able to be revealed those things, oh God, that you desire in us. We thank you again for opening up our minds and our spirit, oh God. We can be able to adhere to all that you have given us. We thank you now. Thank you. It's in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Ephesians 6.
All right. We've been here 10 years now, and
there's so much stuff that all has happened over the course of 10 years that we started this ministry. And at one time, you know, it was real easy. You know, we had about 5 or 6 people, and you know, just came to church. You know, everybody went home, and we didn't stay long in parks. We just kind of just came in here, and we paid our little money, and we went to the house. And now it seems like every year, it's more of a challenge.
All right.
It's more of a challenge. It's more of a challenge to do stuff. But sometimes I get so comfortable in doing nothing, then stuff is a problem. Yeah, it is a problem. And so what God really designed for us, God designed that everybody would take the responsibility of just being kingdom. And if I'm gonna take the design of being kingdom, there are some stipulations of some areas that God designed me to be in. Well, the devil says, in Ephesians 6, the devil didn't say this, but let me tell you what the devil said. But in Ephesians 6 and 10, it said, finally, it said, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might.
Okay.
He said, finally, we've got in this area. Finally. How many of us get to an area and think we've arrived and nothing else happened?
Okay.
It's a comma behind finally. It's not a period, it's not an exclamation point. It's not even a semicolon. It's a comma. That means something's coming after you.
Okay.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Now, I formed English, y'all, so they tell me to take it twice. So I know what commas and exclamation points. Amen. But it says, finally, it says, be strong in the Lord. But it says, my brother, who is my brother? Those that's with me. So in the path that we're going on, in the path that we're going in April, all of us have to be together. You can't ever do nothing separate.
Amen.
In kingdom.
Amen.
You can't ever do nothing separate in kingdom. Now the Lord took me another direction, so y'all just go with me for a minute. You can't ever do nothing separate in kingdom. Because he said, finally, he said, pay attention. We've come in this area. We got to respect God. We got to respect the kingdom. We got to respect leadership.
Amen.
He said, so finally, my brethren, those that are with me, those that's on the right path, the same path. He said, finally, my brethren, he said, be strong. He said, I want to encourage you. He said, you're about to face some stuff. You're about to face some stuff. I say this because all of us, at some instance, we face life's struggles.
Amen.
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 It might not be financial. It might not be health. It might not even be job. But there's something we face. All of us face something. So he said, now if you're gonna really do this, he said, we got to encourage one another.
Amen.
We got to encourage one another.
Amen.
There's no big eyes, little U's. Amen. That kind of craziness. I don't think you can ever grow. You can ever grow ministry trying to, you know, do it by yourself. You know, y'all ever seen a praise team or a one-person praise team?
No, sir.
Amen. Yes, ma'am.
How do you do that if you feel like you have no one else to call upon? Like, you say you reach out.
Let me get close because I can't hear you.
You basically say, like, you reach out to your fellow church members.
Right. So you're saying you don't know who to reach to. Dry?
Yeah.
Okay. That's a good question. That's a very good question. Very good question. Let me tell you something. Boy, I thank God for this lesson tonight. When you think about it, our spirit ought to draw us to people.
Yes, sir.
We should never assume in our mind that that's the person to talk to.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What God does, God allows, we're like a magnet. And they're like metal to our magnet.
Amen.
And magnets always, they connect. Metal,
yes,
and,
sir.
And so when God starts dealing with you, because you're praying now that I need somebody to encourage me, or I need somebody to talk to, I need somebody other than the pastor to talk to. I want to basically talk to somebody. I want to have that person that's in, because we're together. We are together. And so what God does is, because we have a spirit of grace in our lives, God allows that person to connect with us. And I say this because I've done this too many times. God always allows that person that he connected to me to say exactly what God is saying to me. Because there are some people that you can talk to that we believe they got the influence of God in their life, but they don't know how to address your issue.
Amen. Amen.
They don't know how to address your issue. So what they do, they just tell you what they know scripture-wise, but they don't tell you what's in their heart.
Amen.
That makes sense?
Amen.
Yeah, and so when you say, how do I connect? We have to first, it's like protocol. I'm gonna ask God first. And what God does, he lined me up. He's kind of like a Peter and Cornelius situation. He wanted Peter to deal with Cornelius. And so he dealt with Peter first. And when Peter got down to Cornelius' house, they connected. And they were able to do the work because there was a connection there. What your thing is, if your prayer life is where God needed to be, and you're praying that God will give me somebody that I can grow with. Because, again, I asked you Sunday with that scripture you read, Proverbs 27:17 says, iron sharpens iron, so that the man sharpens the countenance of his friend. Well, what actually happens is God connects us with people that's going to sharpen us. They won't ever dull us.
Amen.
They won't ever. If they're going to take from your life, they're not meant for your life.
Amen.
Yeah. 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 So that's how God connects you. So that's how you know that that's the person I need. Yeah.
One more question.
Go ahead.
How do you walk into your calling and your gift?
Yeah, it makes sense. You have to humble yourself first. Because see, sometimes what we try to do, we try to walk in it on our own, but we messed up in that area.
That's right.
See, the Bible told Moses, he said, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord.
Right.
He said, don't move till I move. And so when God told Moses to move, he moved. And the Spirit of the Lord was on Moses because he was at the right. And so where you're at is that I need to move, I need to walk in my calling, but I need to wait on God. Because see, sometimes we go too fast and we want something else to be there and it's not really there.
What if it's there and you resist it?
You resist it. Now, again, you got to humble yourself.
Okay.
Yeah, because now, good question. You should have came last. You were here last week. Girl, I tell you. But the thing is, I ran from preaching for about 5 or 6 years. I ran longer than that, but I ran, and then when God was ready for me to do, I didn't have to run no more. He came and got me.
Okay.
Yeah, and so if you know the calling is there, if you know the calling is there, the Bible says your gifts and calling are without repentance. And so you're gonna actually have to do what you need to do, regardless. I don't care how long you run, you're gonna have to do what God calls. And what God does is, just like you're coming here tonight, come on Sunday morning, we have to prepare ourselves for what God is going to walk us in.
Amen.
We can never be lazy when it comes down. We have to be able, the Bible says, fellowship yourselves among the brethren. And that fellowship is, we got to talk among each other. We got to be able to cross words. We got to be able to cross verses, scripture verses, biblically in the Bible, but that what makes me stronger. And so as I come to Bible class, as I come to church service, as I give praise to God, God is preparing me for the walk in the work that he has for my life. Yeah. They got another question. You sure? Is the floor yours? but and I thank God for asking the question. And don't ever be ashamed to ask a question. Ask a question. You know. But what the devil is trying to do, the devil is trying to stop us.
No. Amen.
He's trying to kill you where you are.
Amen.
And so he will. He will get you to a place where not only Are you nervous about what you need to do? Sometimes, April, we'll sit down on what we're supposed to do. We'll literally just sit down. We'll sit down and we say, well, if they don't ask me, I'm not going to get up. A lot of times God is moving on us to do stuff, but I won't do it. I won't do it because they haven't asked me, they haven't given me an avenue. Well, sometimes the avenue is not for somebody to open it up for you. God has already opened it up. He just needs you to walk in.
Yes,
you know, because really in actuality, the scripture says in Isaiah 1:9, it said, if you're willing and obedient, I'll give you the fruit of the land. And so the willingness is I got to want to. And in my want to, willingness makes me be obedient to the word of God. And so I got a will to do. By me getting up causes the obedience to kick in. And by my obedience kicking in, it causes grace and it causes blessing to come in my life because I'm obedient to God.
Yes.
It's a lot of people don't want to be obedient when it comes down to what God says. And so what I do, I sit down, I back up, I stop. You know, because again, last week I said this, the enemy has some strategies that he throw against us. He put this stuff on us. He messes us up with the strategy because he's watching us.
Amen.
He know our weakest points. He know. And sometimes when God starts growing, a church growing, a kingdom, it gets so much animosity and so much friction in a church. It gets so much stuff in the church. Everybody go get separatism in the church. And because what God want to do, God want to grow the kingdom, but yet we got people that have got reluctant on the word of God. And so friction start coming and we start standing home or we sit down or we do other things because we don't want to do it the way God. The devil have devised a strategy against you. We have to work through those things. Because sometimes we believe it's about us. It's not about you. This is about the kingdom of God. I'm working for the kingdom. I'm working for the king. And so if I'm going to do it God's way, sometimes I do it when I don't want to do it.
Amen.
Amen. Sometimes I walk in places that I don't want to walk in. But I found this out to be true. Every time I start walking with God, because I obey God, I get stronger in where I am because I obey the will of God.
Yeah.
Amen. We get this way because see what the devil trying to do. The Bible says in Revelation 12, it says that the devil stands before God daily accusing you. I mean, he accused you every day. He want God to turn his back on you.
Right. Okay.
And the devil does us like we do people. You know, I used to listen to folk tell me about somebody else. And then we develop an attitude with somebody else. And we don't even know the person. But yet we develop that attitude with that person because somebody over there said, yeah, if you knew them.
Okay.
But what the devil have done, the devil have devised something against that person. And what it did, God wants y'all to get together to make strength in the kingdom. But you already blocked the blessing of God. And I tell people this all the time. Either you're going to allow God to control you, or you're going to let the devil control you.
Okay, you know me,
right? Amen. Because I've seen a lot of people get mad at folk, and they fussing and cussing and going on, and that person at home in the bed is stoned. Amen. They sleep, they go on to bed. Amen. But we allow stuff to control us. The devil is control. If we understand that he have a strategy, that he want to kill your anointing.
Amen.
He want to put the flame out. You know, once you get saved, I'm talking about you're saved, and God has done something in your life, you want everybody to know that God has done something. You're excited, you're reading, you're praying, you believe in God for everything, and then somebody come along and throw water on your fire.
Okay.
Or you throw water. Yeah. Because you say it ain't getting me nowhere. I'm still in it. It's like I'm worse now than I was then. Strategy.
Okay.
That's all it is, strategy.
Okay.
We move from churches. We move from places because the devil has devised a strategy.
Okay.
Amos said, we can't go from house to house or land to land. Why is it? Because you're not letting them grow in you. So if it won't grow in you, then you're not good for kingdom. He devised a strategy. If you're not growing, you're dying.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen.
He said, if I put the stronghold of God in my life, because see, what I really want to develop is, I want to develop such a muscle in me that when the devil come at me, I can look at him in the eyes and not today.
Okay.
Yeah, not today. You're not going to do that to me today. No, that's not going to happen. Because see, what really the devil wants to do, the devil wants you to feel like a weakling.
Amen.
Can't ever feel like a weakling.
Amen.
Can't ever feel like a weakling. Amen. This is what the Bible says. This is what the Bible says. And this is an addition to my lesson. Y'all took me to another place. Listen. This is to my lesson. Every man. Now listen to me good now. Every man that stays at a house with a wife, with children, or whatever it is, he ought to feel like a king.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, he ought to.
Yes, sir.
He ought to feel.
Yes, sir.
And not just feel, he ought to be the king of his house.
Yes, sir.
Now you said, why did you say that? The Bible designed men to have a castle mentality.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. When the people that's in the house don't treat him like king, they have got out of the will of God.
Amen.
And the devil is able to come in a house that the man don't feel like king.
Amen. Amen.
It don't matter how you formed it, how you got it, the Bible is just true.
Yes.
If he is not the king of his house, amen. Because see, a lot of people say, well, you know, she's queen. How can she be queen and he's not king?
Okay, now you
know. Amen. Amen. And so what actually happened, she makes him as well as deal with him like he's royalty. Why do I do it? Because the Bible said that Sarah called Abraham Lord because she respected him. And what actually happened, God allowed grace and blessing to come to the house because she made him king.
Amen.
The devil comes in and mess your house up.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
Yeah. Amen. Because everybody got these options and opinions and thoughts.
Okay.
You ain't gonna treat me that way. My mama told me, see, you messed up already. Church on Sunday morning because him and his wife argued and he don't know how to divorce himself and for his kingdom and house, and he preached a sermon to his wife.
Come on.
He done messed the whole congregation up.
Now you know you're right.
Because the devil done got in there.
Okay.
Amen.
Amen.
So we're at this place. Where's his place? He said, finally, my brother. I got a whole lesson, y'all. Woo!
Okay.
Y'all messed me up there. Listen. He said, finally, my brother.
Okay.
Look at this. In the ninth verse, it says, and ye masters do the same things unto them, forbearing, threatening, knowing that your master is also in heaven. Neither is there respect of persons with him. Why he said, see, it was giving respect to the person that's over you.
Amen.
He said, since we at this place, he said, put on this armor that God has given you. Because if you're not strong in the Lord,
okay.
We keep saying we're saved. But yet we let the devil cause us to get crazy.
No, you're right.
We let the devil cause us to get out of our mind, get out of our intellect. Get out of intelligence. Amen.
Amen.
We have to be mindful of what God is doing in us.
Amen.
Delilah asked a question about what's inside of us. What's inside of us? Every person ought to know when God starts dealing with them inside.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. Because what God has designed the Bible says that the old man dies and the new man shows up.
Yes, he does.
God put Jesus inside of us to direct us.
Amen.
Amen. And so when the glory of God starts moving in us, which is Jesus Christ, what's shown in us shows outside of us, because the glory of God is shown on the outside.
All right.
Amen.
All right.
Now, some people clean up their houses on the outside, but never clean up on the inside.
Now, you know you're right.
Well, it's always designed that I do inside work first. And I work my way outside from the inside. That's the design. That's the design. Because, see, it's crazy that I'm going to have somebody drive up to the house, and it's a beautiful house. But yet when I get on the inside do not reflect the outside.
Or
the outside is real clean, or where the inside is clean, the outside is dirty. And if y'all been to a house sometime, that outside looks all trashy, they got cars and stuff all over, and then you go to the house, just the prettiest house.
Yes, sir.
Think about our lives. Think about your life.
Okay.
Think about your life.
Okay.
God, clean up the inside.
Okay.
Clean up the inside. And so, I really want to show everybody my inside on my outside.
Okay.
Ooh.
Clean floors, clean counters, beds made up, pillows flush.
Wow.
Amen. See no dust, no spiders. It's everything. See them ragged. I believe that if my inside is clean, my outside ought to reflect what's on my inside.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. I don't want to impress nobody with part of the house. I want to impress you with all the house.
All right.
Yeah, I want to impress you with all the house. I was talking to the guy today, and he said, "Man, y'all keep that yard down there, church so clean and everything. I don't like high grass. I don't like high grass.
Okay, you and me
know. I don't like grass. I tell the guy to cut the grass. I said, "Man, don't ever mess with me cutting that grass.
Okay.
Cut the grass." I said, "I ain't got to be there for you to cut it. Just cut it. Call me when you get finished." He cuts the grass, man. We come on the inside, and I like stuff just, and it used to be somebody come in here and clean up. Miss Park's like messing with stuff too, y'all.
Yes, sir.
She picks up stuff. She picks up stuff. But you have to make your house look nice.
Amen. Amen.
Now, what that do, I'm going somewhere, y'all. What that does, it reflect what you feel about God.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. Old folk used to say, cleanliness is next to God.
Yes.
They did. They said.
Yes, sir.
I tried to find that in the Bible. It ain't in the Bible. Old folk used to say, cleanliness is next to God. Amen. And when you think about it, if you're going to really represent God, you're going to represent God.
Yes.
Amen. But the devil don't want you to be clean.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. So the devil puts some spots on you sometimes.
Okay.
He make you act up.
Now you
know. Y'all don't do no acting up. Amen. Let me get finished. Let me tell you this. I don't got all off my lesson now. I'm gonna come back and do that. But one of the strategies I'm reading in this book, one of the strategies that the devil throws at us, he said number one strategy is against your passion. Mm. Against your passion. He seeks to dim your whole desire for prayer. Mm.
Okay.
He dull your interest in spiritual things and downplay the potency of your most strategic weapon. The devil want to dull your prayer.
Yes.
She got to pray to God.
When that happens, what do you do?
You come back to God. You have to get in that secret place.
You're getting that, I'm talking to me and God.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Now, I get in my car sometimes, a lot of ride. I like riding. It's just me and God. I talk to radio off, God in my head, and I know I've gotten to that place. And one of the things a friend of mine talked about the other day is that he said he had stopped praying. And I told him I had stopped reading as much as I used to read. And I said, God is pushing me back to that area. He said, yeah, God is pushing me. And so what we did, we separated. We together almost every day. We were together. And so we wouldn't go eat breakfast. We wouldn't go eat lunch. We wouldn't talk to each other. And so 5-6 days, we didn't hear from each other. And so but when we came together, we discussed this. It was crazy that we discussed it. But it was that time that we had to get back to that place where we were with God.
Amen.
Because you can't, and see, the good part about it is when you notice that.
Yeah.
See, that's the thing. See, if you went by and didn't know, that's when you'd be in trouble.
Yeah.
But since you know where you are, when you know where you are, and you know that the devil had come in there and knocked that out, you say, okay, God, I need to feel you. I need your presence. I need to know that you're listening. I know that you're hearing me. I need to know that you're right there with me. And what God said, I'll answer you just where you are. Yeah, because see, if I let the devil get me and he get me too far out and I can't come back, then I got an issue. I got a real issue. And that's why Paul said, he said, finally, he said, be strong in the Lord. Because see, your strength is gonna really, really be relied on what has been imputed in you. Every word, everything that I've sold in you, every word that you've got, every sermon that you've got been sold in you, that stuff comes up when you get in a desperate place. Yeah, God always reminds you where you are. He always reminds you, this is what I shared with you. And so in those dull moments to where he tried to deal with your prayer life, that's the time I need to get real close to God. I don't need to turn your phone on. I don't need to answer the phone. I need to. It's just me and God. And God will give you that time. He will give you that time. Even when Carlos is your baby, God will give you that time to be just with him.
Okay.
And they will understand where you are at that time. But the devil wanted them.
He wanted.
Because see, if a lot of the younger people get saved, if a lot of the younger people get saved and God really starts doing, see, we're in a millennial period now. If y'all get saved, and I'm talking about really strong in God, and all the stuff that's going on now, the people that y'all can impact in life, just the kingdom. Oh no, the devil don't want you praying.
Okay.
No, the devil don't want you praying because you'll cause too much friction in his kingdom if you're praying.
Amen.
Because there's too many people who listen.
Amen.
There's too many people who listen. So I shared this yesterday when I first started preaching, I preached my first sermon. We was down there, Thousand Oak Drive down there. And we was in a storefront, we was in a building, kind of half of this. We got two office buildings. There was two offices. And they heard that I was going to preach my first sermon. I think everybody in Jackson was there. I think everybody in Jackson, Terry, Kapow County. Yeah, there's everybody there. Chicago, some white folk there, some black folk. You know, and a lot of them was there because I had lived such a crazy life, such a bad life. When you said he was called to what? He was called to prison. You got to be kidding me. They all showed up. The people all out the doors. People all out the door. But I remember the sermon that God gave me. Like it was yesterday, I talked about what God will you serve in times like these.
Come on.
And what God did, he made a platform for the ministry he had before me.
Okay.
And so even now, because my goal, my destiny, my destination is that souls get saved through what I say. And so the devil, he throwed a whole lot of stuff at me. Even my pastor came and told me, and I talked about a lot of things that day. He came and said, now you can't talk about that when you get up there. People ain't gonna call you preaching. People ain't. They just told me. But I knew what God had called me to do.
Okay.
And so a lot of the standing that you do, the devil don't want you standing there. So he'll get influential people to come to you and tell you, look, you can't do that.
Okay.
You can't say it that way. Don't come in there and put that on.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Because see, your drive is different than your leader.
Okay.
In some senses. Because see, I believe this in every leader. I'm talking about even with me. I believe that God give me input to put in you all.
Yes, sir.
And the only thing is doing, I'm your foundation. You ought to grow off the foundation that's been laid for you.
Amen.
You ought to go higher than I am at this point. Because what we've done is, it shows that I've taught something when you can get up here.
All right. Amen.
Yeah. And so the devil don't ever want you to get to that place of really being able to have a strong prayer life. I mean, a real strong prayer life. Because when we start praying, it's something happening, saints start praying. It's something happening, saints start praying. And then it says, though your interest in spiritual things. Now, y'all know, all of us have been through that. The church can be spiritual, the church can be high. I mean, we can shout every Sunday, but it's at some point the devil comes in and start killing that drive.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah. Most of y'all know how many people have come to this church.
Yes, sir.
They come in, they'll help, they'll do, they just do, and then all of a sudden one day, the Lord moved me. Mm. Told me to do something. Mm-hmm. That spiritual drive is dulled by what the devil.
Amen.
Because I think if the church is going to grow, the kingdom is going to grow, it's grown by people that first have an expectancy, and then you have a push that you're going to push, and then you're going to invest in where you are.
That's right.
You got to invest where you are. You got to invest where you are. If you're not investing where you are, then you don't trust where you are.
Amen.
Yeah, you got to invest. Amen. Because see, that's just what the devil wants you to lose spiritual interest. He wants you to get upset about stuff.
Amen.
You
know? Amen.
Yeah, he wants your spiritual eye to get dim. And so that's what he wants. And so you said, oh, I ain't gonna have food in the room this morning.
Okay.
Yeah. Amen. And so that's one of the things. And then downplay the potency of your most strategic weapons. And most of us, we got prayer, we got song, we got praise. Those are your weapons.
Amen.
If you get in a high praise, the devil ain't coming in there.
Okay.
Yeah, you get you a good worship going on.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Hey, no. It's real genuine. No. The devil don't want part of that. No. So he does that. And then the next thing is, it says he come against your focus.
Okay.
Oh, God.
Yes, sir.
I can't stay focused.
Okay.
I can't stay focused. Something always it grabs my thoughts.
Okay.
Can't stay. You know, come in church and say I'm up preaching. And I can't tell you where you come from. Because, you know, I lost my focus.
Okay.
I lost my focus. Then he said something. I knew that was something. I lost my focus. Ain't that something? God is really trying to deal with me in a lot of things, and he really want to pick me up. I mean, he really, I'm talking about, I want to strengthen me. Because we all realize that God loves us so much that he takes us even our weakest moments, and he gives us what we need in our weakest moments.
Yes,
Paul
sir.
Said, when I'm weak, I'm weak, I'm yet made strong.
Yes, sir.
In my week, you know, those days I just really want to throw in the towel. I'm not doing this no more. You want to kill my focus.
Okay.
You want to kill my focus. If I can just stay focused, if I can keep my mind, you know, most of the old people said, just keep your mind on Jesus, baby. Just keep your mind on Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Amen. You have to stay. I've talked to pastors that maybe are having extramarital affairs.
Okay.
I've talked to pastors. They can't get out of the affair. And I would always tell them, so you got to stay focused.
Yes, sir. Okay.
I never condemned him. And why did I condemn? Why didn't I tell him, you going to hell?
Okay.
I couldn't tell him that.
Right.
I couldn't tell him that.
Right.
Why? The Bible said we're not condemned.
That's it. That's
yeah,
it.
I can't condemn. I can do the same thing.
That's it.
Yeah. Same thing. Yeah. So I tell them all the time, stay focused. One guy, he had a girlfriend, and I told him, I said, you got to stay focused. I told him both things too. I can't tell y'all what it was. But I told I told him both things too, but after a while he went home, yeah. He went to the house. He went home and he told me, he said, man, I thank you because see, I want to be a friend to you first.
Amen.
I need to be a friend to you first. If we ever lose focus, we can't be friends to people.
Amen.
Because we can't shop with people we don't like.
Amen. Amen.
You can't shop with people you don't like. And so you have to be a friend to them first. But see, what the devil said, he wanna come against your focus. And it says he disguises himself and manipulates your perspective. So you end up focusing on the wrong culprit, directing your weapons at the wrong enemy.
Okay.
All right.
Amen. Amen. You looking at somebody that ain't the person you need to be. Huh? You have to stay focused. You have to stay focused. You gotta keep your eyes just where it need to be. Yeah, because if you take your eyes off where you're going, you'll fall in a ditch. Amen. Now, there's a lot of things they tell you not to text on your phone now. I've known a lot of people have wrecks and running ditches and things. Because they got their phone, they texting and all. They try to look. You know, Mario had me in the truck with him one day, and he was playing on that phone. I now look. You can't drive me and on the phone too like that now. You gotta stop the truck. I get out of the walk. I'll get out of the walk now. But that's down with the devil. The devil wanna get your eyes off of what Christ is saying to you. Yeah, he wanna get you to a place where you lose focus. See, God has gave you an assignment. He done gave you an assignment. And we lose focus on our assignment and we start doing other things. He manipulates us in that area.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, he manipulates us in those areas. He manipulates us. And so we have to stay focused, because he ever come against your focus. Yeah. Now, let me say this. How many of y'all like abundance? Yeah, God said, I'll give you life. Come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Mm-hmm. All of us like abundance. And sometimes we go through an area to where we're in a drought. Mm-hmm. Well, that drought don't determine that we're gonna stay there. If you can stay focused,
okay,
then God will let the abundance fall on you if you stay focused.
Yes.
And that's why Paul said, finally, be strong in the Lord. Because see, sometimes God will let you go in a drought so you can depend on where he is with you.
Mm-hmm.
If your focus is right, and I don't get my eyes off where I am. You know, it's kind of like running out of gas. You know, don't put your eyes on the needle that's on the car.
Okay.
Keep your eyes on the road, because I need to see how far I can get on the gas I have.
Okay.
But I take my eyes off the gas hand, because see, sometimes the light of the gas hand might be wrong.
You know you're right.
The float in the gas tank might not be reading it right.
Okay.
Now, I thought I was going to run out of gas at some time or another, but made it to the gas station. Put gas in the car. I have run out of gas at the gas pump.
Okay.
But I stayed focused on where I was going.
Amen. Amen.
You got to stay focused.
Amen.
Most people that teach you exercise, and you're on a treadmill, they tell you to put a towel over the top of the treadmill so you won't see how far you walk. They tell you, just stay focused, keep walking. And then you're going to get tired at some point.
Okay.
You're tired at some point. You take the towel off, you actually went further on the treadmill than you actually thought in your mind. But if you keep your eyes focused, you're going to mess up. Have you ever been looking on the treadmill? I've been on the treadmill. You're looking, You look on and you're going side to side. You're going like you're going to fall off that treadmill. It's because you got your eyes on that pedal. Keep your eyes up front. Let's just stay.
Okay.
Amen. Because if you ever lose focus, it's just little stuff.
Yeah.
It's little stuff. I'm talking about even relationship. It's little stuff.
Amen.
What is that saying? That's right. He took his eyes off of where he needs to be.
Yes.
Yeah. And you get to this point. You lose focus. The devil wants you to lose focus.
Amen.
And then it says he come against your identity. Some of us don't know who we are. Amen. He said he magnifies your insecurities. Leading you to doubt what God says about you and to disregard what he's given you. You lose your identity.
Okay.
It's a lot of us God have called out to do some stuff.
Amen.
Because we're insecure where we are.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a strategy the devil has. It's a strategy that he has. Now, think about, I said this a few months ago. I said, we didn't come to take charge, we come to take over.
Come on now.
When you walk in a room, people ought to know that God sent you.
Amen.
Now, if you that with me Sunday, if y'all notice, I just glided on in. I just glided on in. Just like I was ready, just glided on in. I didn't have to stop and pause and nothing like that. Just glided on in.
Okay.
Because I knew what my assignment was.
All right now.
I knew what I went for. And then I didn't have to get them to tell me who I was. You have to know who you are in Christ.
That's right. Okay.
If the devil, if God has called you for an assignment,
amen.
You ought to know it. I don't care who tell you, no, I don't believe that.
Okay.
I don't care what you believe.
Right.
If you know God has called you out, I don't have to get affirmation from nobody.
That's okay.
When God has already given it to you.
You have to know
that the devil won't come against your identity.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. How many of y'all know who you are?
Amen.
Amen. God called you. Yes, Lord. Amen. And then it said that the devil, next strategy, he'll come against your family.
Yes, he does. Yes.
Ouch!
He does.
Yes, he will.
Big time.
Yes, he will. He'll tear family up.
Okay.
Yeah, he will. He'll tear. Yeah. He'll tear family up.
Yes, he will.
He will tear family up.
You know you're right.
Amen. Now, I'm going to tell y'all something. Let me read this verse and then tell you. He wants to disintegrate your family, dividing your home, rendering it chaotic, restless, and unfruitful.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
You know what, Pastor? Sometimes the devil won't even bother you.
That's right.
He'll afraid your family.
He won't touch you.
He won't touch you. He'll go straight to your family. Your whole family.
That's right. That's right. And she's right about it. Because see, the devil know he can't touch you. Yeah, he know he can't touch you. But he'll let your son or your daughter come against you. You wonder, what in the world happening?
Crazy.
I got a long day mind. But it happens. It happens. But that's what the devil wanna do. You think about it. That we had the best family, we had the best this, we did this, we vacationed, we went over here, we always together, and then one day, boom! Hallelujah.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Now you know you're right.
What does that cause a family? Because see, when you said that I want to put a kingdom together, but I can't keep family together. Yeah, because see, really in actuality, most people, and we as blacks, I don't know about white folks, but I know black folk always hold stuff over your head. Hold stuff over your head. Yeah. And you actually have to prove yourself.
Yes, sir.
You have to prove yourself to be what God called. Because see, somebody asked me several years ago, they said, you still counsel people, couples? And I said, oh yeah, I counsel couples. They said, how you counsel couples? You got divorced. I said, I'm the best man for the job.
Okay.
I said, I'm the best man for the job. Because I know what to do and what not to do.
Amen.
Amen. Because see, now I got some inside connection.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I got some insight. And so I didn't let them stop me from doing what I had been called to do. Because so we have to keep building.
Amen.
We have to keep building. You can't pull yourself out of the equation because somebody can't see you in it.
Amen.
Yeah. But the family part is the family. I counsel couples even now. And I counsel before marriage. They got children involved. I want the children to come to the counseling session. Because I need to know where you are. I need you to know this is what's going to happen. For God to stay where he's going to be in your family, this is how it's going to happen. Because I need to see where the church. Because see, if you got a son and your son don't like your new hug, amen. Because see, what it's going to call, it's going to call you to have to choose sides, and that never should be.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
No.
Amen. Amen.
You should never have to choose sides.
Amen.
You're gonna love your husband. You're gonna love your son, and they're gonna all get together.
That's it.
And I'm not gonna let the devil stop me.
Amen.
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 Amen. But that's what he does. He come in to tear families up.
He would definitely do it.
He would destroy our family. I'm talking about. Because see, when you think, and if the family get tore up, how much stuff actually happens? Family really get tore up. It takes a long time to get it right back together.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Long
yes,
time.
Sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Something done to fill out the wall. He said, "Humble, dumb, had a great fall. All the king men, good put up and dumb it back to him. King, good God of mercy." I'm telling you, when the devil gets in like that,
yes, sir.
And he can start tagging up,
yes, sir.
And before long, I mean, it's just too far.
Yes, sir.
It's too far to reach him.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's too far to reach him.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And then some things start happening. And the crazy part about that, when people get so far apart, we as a people don't have the conscience or the know-how to come back.
That's it.
Yep. We hate to say I'm sorry.
That's right.
We hate to say I was wrong.
That's right.
Even when you wasn't wrong, let me just take it. I'm wrong. And it's not that I'm the bigger person.
Amen.
I'm trying to get the devil out of my family.
Amen.
That makes sense?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. It says, let me say this. Boy, I'm padding time. Woo!
All right.
The devil want to come against your confidence.
Okay.
Yeah. Goodness. Now, a lot of people say I'm arrogant. I'm not arrogant. I'm confident. And it says here, he constantly reminds you of your past mistakes. in bad choices, hoping to convince you that you're under God's judgment rather than under the blood. I don't know if Miss Jean remember the seminar went down that day when I said this. I said to Oak Ridge one time, I said, now if somebody tell you that I got a baby bottle and I don't know it, I said, I can't tell you no, so don't charge it to me. I said, I've been in the street. I said, I wanna tell you before they come. Hey. It is what it is. It is. You can't look. I don't care how you throw something at me. I've already told them.
Okay.
You can't blackmail me with stuff I've already told.
Okay.
Amen. God don't want the devil to get you to a point where you lose your confidence where you are.
Amen.
Paul said we're more than confident. God is designing us. Everybody got a past.
Amen.
They say every sinner has a past, but every saint has a future.
Amen.
Amen. Every saint has a future. So if the devil can kill your confidence. He can kill your confidence. He can kill you.
Yes, he can. All
right.
That's right.
Amen. He'll hit you in the jugular vein.
Okay.
And kill your confidence. Amen. Because see, we talked about the passion, the focus, the identity, the family. If he kill your confidence, he can kill other four.
Amen.
If he kill work, God, and placed in you.
What was the four family words?
Confidence. Yeah. You got passion, focus, identity, family, and confidence.
Okay.
Amen. You want to mess you up?
I'm sorry, it's my family, confidence, passion, identity, and what else?
You talk about
focus.
Focus. See, you lost focus. Amen. Wow.
That's so true. Yeah. I have to say, you know, Sister Jean, like you said, how you have to pray for your family and your children. And, you know, I think sometimes you find it hard to do or think it's a hard task to do because go back to that confidence. You know, even sometimes I think back and I reflect back, okay, this morning, what did I pray for? This afternoon, what did I pray for? Even when you pray for your children, you know, pleading the blood of Jesus over their lives, it, because of the confidence you have in the Lord, it becomes so natural, it becomes so easy, and the devil comes to you and say, you know, did you pray for him? You know, are you still worried about him? I can pray for him, but the confidence is, I easily ask God to do something for me, and because I stand in faith with God, well, the confidence I have in God, I can't worry about what I just prayed for. I can't even be concerned about what I prayed for because I put it in God's hand. If I put my job in God's hand, if I put my finances in God's hand, if I put my health in God's hand, if I put comfort on my family in God's hand, my confidence is in the Lord. I know He'll do what He said He'll do.
Okay?
That's what I'm confident in. It becomes easy. The more you do it, it becomes easy, and that enemy will try to come and throw all that trash in that garbage at you and try to get you all focused. But your passion, you know, I love the Lord. That's my passion. Loving the people of God. My passion is, you know, loving that word of God and meditating with God. And then my focus is I got to surround my focus on the things of God, and I can't surround them on all of these other things around me because it's so easy to do because the enemy is there trying to make you do that. Then your family, yeah, he can tell the family that we stand down and the war is for Christ. Okay. And so your confidence is because, you know, my confidence in Christ, all of that's taken care of.
Amen.
It just becomes easy. Okay.
Amen. But we have to know that if the devil have devised strategies against us, are you going to devise one against him?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Are you going to devise one against him? Are you going to, you know, we got to have an escape.
Amen.
An exit plan.
Amen.
Amen. If the fire break out, they want to have an escape out of the building.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Other than you going to a familiar place, you got to go to a safe place.
Right.
Have we devised a plan?
Yes, sir.
You know, because like I said, there's so many things. And I don't know our time. You know, let me give you all these other five. I'm not going to go over them. I'm just tell you what they are. The devil will go against your calling.
Calling?
Yes.
Way past.
the devil will go against your calling, and what it says is he'll amplify fear, worry, and anxiety until they are the loudest voices in your head, causing you to dim the adventure of following God too risky to attempt. And then he go against your purity.
Okay.
He tries to tempt you towards certain sins, convincing you that you can tolerate then without risking consequence, knowing their only way is the distance between you and God.
Okay.
And then he comes against your rest and contentment.
Oh my.
He hopes to overload your life,
okay,
and schedule, pressuring you to constantly push beyond your limits, never feeling permission to say no.
Yeah. Okay.
He comes against your heart.
Heart.
Your heart. H-E-A-R-T. Your
the
heart.
Heart.
The heart. He uses every opportunity to keep old wounds fresh in mind.
Okay.
Knowing that anger and hurt and bitterness and unforgiveness will continue to roll the damage forward. And then he comes against your relationship.
Oh my.
He creates disruption and disunity within your circle of friends and within the shared community of the body of Christ.
Okay. Okay.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen. That devil is something.
He is.
Amen.
He is.
Amen. Now, we're going to pray.
Yes, sir.
But Paul says, put on the whole armor of God.
Oh, that's right.
And there are six pieces that talk about putting on that whole armor. But there's a seventh piece. A seventh piece. And that seventh piece is prayer.
All right now.
That seventh piece is prayer. We got to always pray. We got to always pray. We have to always pray. Amen. What a lesson.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Amen. Thank you, man.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Y'all think we can handle those?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Without a doubt.
I want to encourage you, though. I want to encourage all of us. The enemy that us. How old are you, baby? 27 years old. 27 years old. And just want to love God. Just want to love God. Tell you, 27 years old, want to love God. And everything is to be fruitful around. It seems like the devil want to kill it just where he is. We need to cover her as well as she covers other people around her. Family. The church need to be in a position. And Delilah said something a while ago. Stayed in the spirit.
Alright.
Delilah shouldn't have to look for somebody at Omega to come to.
That's right. Amen.
She ought to feel free enough in here.
Amen.
Our goal when we started here is the freedom that God gives us to worship Him. And so many people have come here and said, I feel the freedom at that church.
Okay.
if we as a people can't feel the freedom and everybody else can come in and feel free, there's something wrong with the unity we have.
Amen.
I want her to feel the freedom. Amen. To know that the people that God will send her way, that they're gonna first be private in her area, and then gonna be even be strong enough to help her in her area.
Amen.
Because it don't make sense for us to be in a place of worship and we can't worship God in spirit and in truth.
Amen.
Now. I'm finna close. I want to meet, y'all keep this in y'all head for me, and I'm gonna try to do it on Sunday. I need to meet Sam and Cynthia and Jasmine, Miss Ruby, Miss Jean, Miss Brenda, Miss Regina on Sunday.
Okay.
Y'all got that?
Yes, sir.
Take a little while. And what I'm, and it's been in my spirit all week since Sunday. We need to stop just doing stuff. We need a structure.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In y'all's ministries.
Yes, sir.
What's going to be convenient,
yes,
for
sir.
Obey. It's got to be convenient.
Amen.
And conducive for Obey.
Amen.
Okay.
We're gonna
have to walk in excellence. We're gonna have to walk.
Amen.
I need to, just for a few minutes, I need to make you feel. All right. Thank God, Miss Annie.
Amen.
Miss Annie, I'm not going to tell you what I was thinking in my head.
Okay.
That's good. I'm not going to say it out open. I'll say it after. Thank God for you being with us tonight.
Amen.
Let's pray. We have a prayer request,
Pastor. So I got an old friend, lived in Louisville, and she had a massive stroke yesterday. Her stepped on and told her, so they're not expecting her to make it. She's a Tupelo. And Deontae and preacher met her last year when we were up in Starfield, named Louise Cravens.
Reeves?
No, Louise Craven.
Louise?
Uh-huh, yeah.
Louise, okay. What's her last name, sorry?
Cravens.
Cravens?
Cravens.
Cravens.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Okay, Cravens. All right, LaFoya called this afternoon. She had surgery this morning. And, she said she got a little pain, but she's doing okay. She said they probably let her out tomorrow. I told her we put on a prayer. So we're praying for her. Pray for my mom. We ask that she continue that. She's okay, but I just want us to continue to keep her covered.
Amen.
Keep her covered.
Amen.
And then we want to pray for each other.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Pray for each other.
Yes, sir.
God will be with us. I want us to be mindful of what God is doing now. He's doing a lot of stuff. It's not time to get slack or lax. Where we are, it's time for us to take the battle hymn and say, listen, I'm ready to go. So God can do what he's done for us. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. We thank you, God, now for tonight.
Thank you.
Bless you, Master, for what you've done in words. We thank you, God, now that how you have lift us up, give us revelation, and give us insight, oh God, of the strategies that the devil has tried to put against us. But we pray for strength now. Pray for your guidance. We pray for your anointing, God. We pray that you will build up such a strength in us, oh God. We don't want just a hedge around us, oh God, to be hiding behind the hedge. But, Master, we want to have the strength to fight the enemy just where he is. We want to be able to look him in the eye and say, not today. We thank you, God, that we have a word in our belly, oh God. And, Master, we'll be able to set our mouth. That, Master, the devil have to flee just as his appearance will flee from us, God. So, God, I thank you now for tonight. I thank you, God. For these persons, oh God, have come tonight, oh God. I thank you for the questions. I thank you, oh God, for the input. I thank you, God, for just the reception that was made tonight, God. But we pray, oh God, now that we'll continue to decrease in ourselves, oh God, and that we'll increase in you.
Pray, oh God, now that we'll alleviate where we are and where we think we are and our mindset and our intelligence and our know-how, God. And now, so we ask that you will fill us up, God, with that that you've given unto us, that we'll be able to build the kingdom according to your will and your way, God. We pray, Master, now for our homes. We pray for families, oh God. We pray, oh God, for our minds, oh God. And Master, our mind will continue to stay strong and elevated to you, God. And Master, we'll be able to know the people that you're sending us to, the assignment that we have around us, God. We pray, oh God, now for just the strength of just continue walking through day by day, God. And then, Master, the names that were called out, oh God, the person, oh God, that the doctors that are trying to give up, oh God. Master, we realize that you have the last word, God. And so, God, we pray now that your healing power will continue to take place and make way in Tupelo, God. We ask, oh God, that you continue to keep your arm around her, even in LaFoya, oh God, the thing that's going on in her, oh God, in her body, relying that she healed because of what you've already said, oh God. And so, God, I pray now. I pray for my mom, and I pray for other people around us, oh God. We pray especially for Omega family, oh God. We pray for Delilah in a special way, oh God, because of what she's thirsted and hungry for, God. We pray, oh God, that we'll cover her, oh God, and every person that she will pray for, every person that she will call out their name, oh God. Master, you'll honor her, oh God, by healing and honoring them, God. We thank you, oh God, even for the people that are here tonight, oh God, and how you've allowed us to hear such a word tonight. We pray, oh God, for Omega as a whole, God. We pray for Ms. Annie, oh God. We pray for her strength. We pray for her guidance, oh God. We pray for her protection, God. We pray for the thing that she's pushing and pulling for, God. We thank you, God, even for the thirst that's in her, God. I ask now that you continue to wrap your arms around her and her family, that, Master, that everything that she desires for them, oh God, Master, it'll become manifest in their home. I ask now that you just bless this place, that, Master, it'll be a fuel station, oh God, for everybody that will come through, God. Thank you again for tonight. I thank you for what you're doing in us, God. I thank you for the rejuvenation, oh God, that you allowed in us where we had failed back, we have gotten reluctant, we got lax, oh God. But now you're pushing us to a place, oh God, that you'll be God in our lives. So I said thank you again for all that you're doing in this place. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.